With a writable bitmap, you can generate image data, then load it into the bitmap and display it. So with a writable bitmap, you can do things like you can load it from, say, a bitmap here, where I have this BI thing, and then I can, so if I load the bitmap image from a stream, I can then put it into a writable bitmap, and I can get an int array. So then I can change that int array however I want or whatever. The reason I'm showing this is because for the homework that I'm about to give out, this homework will want you to load in an image from file, and then you're going to merge it into the camera stream somehow. You're going to like take that image and you're going to copy it over a location in the camera, like live preview video stream that's coming through. You're going to be taking an image and just kind of pasting it over a certain location in the image stream. And in order to do that, you have to get the raw pixel values. And to get the raw pixel values, you get that with this writable bitmap thing. Because the writable bitmap thing allows you to get the int array, which you can then pass to your C++ code to do the actual image processing. Does that make sense? Because otherwise, you would have no idea what the actual pixel values of whatever picture that you have stored on your phone is. All right. So this is a good chance to talk about part one of homework five, which some of you have asked me how many homeworks there'll be, and I originally said there would be 6 homeworks. But I'm changing that now to 5 homeworks because I'm merging homework 5 and homework 6 into one and cutting out a piece of homework 5 that just wasn't very exciting. So what this means is homework 5 will be due in 2 weeks instead of 1, and this will be the last homework. There will be final project proposals due next week. I'll probably have them due like Tuesday or Wednesday next week, so you have a chance to talk to me both on Sunday and Monday next week. But the reason why I merged the 2 homeworks together is because last year we had the final project proposals due and people had just barely learned that we even had these little Arduino hardware things that we can communicate with over Bluetooth. So that's why we're also going to talk about Bluetooth communication today, so that you guys have a week to play around with these devices, see what you can do with them a little bit before making decisions on what you can do with your final projects, so you're kind of fully informed. So the first part of homework 5 will be to do real-time image stream capture and processing. What you're going to do is some what I call creative image processing. You're going to make an image processing app that will track a simple marker. Now, most people, when they say a marker, they mean like a 2D barcode or something. We're going to be doing much simpler than that. It's going to be a red rectangle. You're going to look for a red rectangle in your image stream. You're going to find the location of it, and then you're going to paste a predefined image on top of that. So, simplest case is you find a red rectangle, you take that little star thing from your application icon, and you just paste it over the top of it. Now, when I say paste it over the top of it, I don't mean you're going to like change the size and stuff. You can if you want, but you'll just, you know, put a rectangle on top of it. And just that operation that I've said right there will probably take you a couple days to figure out how to do it properly, because image processing is weird and suddenly fun. The way that you find the location of the red rectangles, the way that you even recognize a red rectangle, is completely up to you. I will be providing some libraries that make it a little easier to work with pixel data. So it will allow you to do things like, you can say like, you know, it'll be a data type called like pixel frame or something like that. And you can say frame x, y. And it will automatically do the thing where it finds x and y like this. So you don't have to do like x times width or y times width plus x, that kind of stuff. And it'll allow you to, hello there. It will allow you to get the red channel or the green channel or the blue channel without having to worry about doing bit fiddling and stuff like that, because it's all one big integer and things like that. to make it a little easier. But beyond that, it's pretty much up to you guys. So there's no mathematical algorithms that you have to implement or anything like that. It's all just you guys and the data. Yes?
Two questions. So I assume the red rectangle will give us a size, or we can just be any red rectangle we consider red rectangle?
So I don't have a demo application to show you right now because I haven't gone through my old code to build it again. But let's say that this is the red rectangle, and you have your phone looking at it. And so your image could be this big, or you could zoom really in and your image could be this big. I want you to recognize both of those cases. So you can define a size where you say, I will consider a red rectangle that's smaller than a certain amount. That's fine. But if I move it around and stuff, it should still recognize it fairly well.
And we need to recognize it at any orientation.
Ideally, yes. So, I mean, chances are you'll probably come up with a couple algorithms that work just fine when the rectangle's like this, and then when the rectangle's like this, it breaks horribly. Or it thinks that, like, this is the red rectangle. I'm not going to be super picky about this. I want something that works reasonably well. The idea behind this is that you want to get used to kind of image tracking, image registration, that kind of thing. I'm not looking for you to go out, implement, like, SIFT, the state-of-the-art image feature tracking, you know, algorithm that does rotational invariance, scale invariance, and finds the perfect lines and, you know, is able to align your thing properly. That's not really what I'm looking for. That would be great, but that's not really what I'm asking for. What I am looking for is something that runs in real time. So I don't want to move the phone around and have it go you know, I want something smooth. That's something that I think is a skill that is going to be really helpful for your final projects, is being able to write algorithms that will run smoothly. So, yeah. Any other questions? All right. Let's zoom backwards a little bit and talk about Bluetooth. So, Bluetooth is going to be another fun thing for us to work with. It was originally a short-range wireless protocol developed by Intel, and I love this. Its poster child was a toaster that could burn the weather onto your toast. That was like their killer app for Bluetooth at first, was their toaster could communicate over Bluetooth to some base station. It could figure out the weather, and it could like burn like a sun or a cloud onto your toast. Because I guess it was too hard to look out the window or something. So eventually, they figured out that, hey, these cell phone things could sure use something like this. So after many iterations of the standard, we now have something that works pretty well. Its original goals were to be low power, ubiquitous, and something. Variable bandwidth. That's the one. Now with like Bluetooth 3.0, Bluetooth 4.0, we have a pretty darn good standard. Bluetooth 1.0 was maybe not exactly what everybody wanted, but it did end up gaining traction, so that's why we all use it. And we're going to use it to control third-party hardware. So things like this phone Astra board that I have talked about a little bit. It is a little Arduino, for those of you that know what that is. And considering the audience I'm talking to, I actually think a good amount of you probably do know what an Arduino is. It's a little board like this. It has a built-in Bluetooth module right here. It's got an SD card that you can fit in right here if you want to store data on the device. It's got a bunch of general I/O and drivers and such. And it's got a serial interface that we can program it with. And it's got a piezo buzzer, which is my favorite. So what you guys are going to do is you're going to write the software for both sides. You'll write the software to run the phone that will communicate over Bluetooth, and write the software for the device that will be in C that will communicate over Bluetooth and do something. And so the idea behind having yet another like moving part in this huge programming task is you're going to be able to do things like sensing on the phone, which is hopefully for you getting to be pretty natural now. You can say, like, oh, I know how to get data from the accelerometer. Oh, I know how to get data from the microphone. And if you want to, say, build a robot or build a mechanical arm or something that does something, wiring that up to the phone is going to be pretty hard. So instead, we wire it up to the Arduino and then control the Arduino from the phone. And this is where we start to get into the controls part of the class. So let's just talk a little bit on the phone side of how we do something like communicate with the Arduino. The first thing is, of course, we have to enable Bluetooth on the phone. We have to ask for permissions and stuff like that. Bluetooth has a thing called pairing, which I'm sure you've all wrestled with at one point in your lives. Pairing is basically a way to stop Bob from using Alice's Bluetooth headset. So they're like little mini passwords on every Bluetooth device, except that the passwords are usually 0000 or 1234. In our case, I'm pretty sure if it asks for a PIN, it's 0000. Go figure. The other reason this is pairing is useful is because things will only pair at certain times. Like a Bluetooth headset will only pair when you first turn it on, for instance. So that's the other thing that stops Bob from using Alice's Bluetooth headset. Some other smarter Bluetooth devices will actually have a PIN. Like when you try and connect two phones, they'll actually generate like a random PIN that you have to pull again, but whatever. For us, we just have to pair it once, and then it remembers it for the rest of its lifetime. Or until it gets paired with something else. So on the Arduino side, we'll have to open Bluetooth communication. On the phone side, we'll have to open up Bluetooth communication. And then we can write data out and read data in, and it will just magically disappear from one side and reappear on the other side. The way that we do Bluetooth on Windows Phone 8 is to ask for it in the capabilities, and then, like, in your phone settings, you just have to turn Bluetooth on. Once you do that, your Bluetooth is always awake and searching for devices and available to be paired with. We use this Peer Finder class thing to search for nearby devices. This Peer Finder thing is not only used for Bluetooth devices, but also for like Wi-Fi and things like that. So when we use it, we're going to tell it only search over Bluetooth. But you can use the same kind of thing to do, like, for instance, some students made a baby monitoring application. Well, okay, more than a few students, but they made a baby monitoring application where they streamed video from one to the other. And in order for the phones to find each other, they used this Peer Finder class where they brought their phones next to each other and used the NFC, which is the near field communication, to tell each other, hey, like, I'm at this address. Then they could use Peer Finder to find each other over Wi-Fi and communicate over Wi-Fi, which is actually kind of cool. Once you've got a peer, you open what's called a stream socket. And a stream socket is the most basic TCP and Bluetooth communication method. It represents a continuous stream of data. So those of you who had thought we were done with streams when we were dealing with images were wrong. Streams mean that it's an infinite flow of data, and it will just tell you how many bytes are available for reading right now. So when I open up a socket to talk to the Arduino, and the Arduino opens up a socket to talk to me, I can write out 80 bytes, and then it can read so many bytes. But the underlying communication is not continuous. The underlying communication happens in packets. Those of you who have taken any kind of networking or communications classes know that we don't just constantly send electromagnetic waves back and forth. We send them in discrete chunks. And on the OS level, when we send chunks back and forth, some chunks can be dropped, some chunks get lost because someone else transmits on the same frequency at the same time, etc. So not all of the data is guaranteed to make it there at the same time. I may get the first half of my message across, but then I have to retransmit the second half of my message. And if the Arduino, while it's listening, tries to read in data, it may read in the first half at the beginning and then read in the second half later. It won't wait for the entire message to arrive before it starts reading it in. That's why it's called stream-based communication, as opposed to like datagram-based communication, like UDP. And so a good chunk of the communication on the internet is all done over this stream kind of processing, where you are responsible for knowing that I have an entire message here. So this brings us into the world of things like protocols. Protocols are easy and neat because you get to make them up and you just have to be consistent with yourself and then they work. These protocols are things like, if I want to send messages to the Arduino, I can do things like say, the first 4 bytes of every message are going to be an integer with the size of the following data. So if I'm transmitting audio that I want it to play out of its little piezoelectric buzzer, I can say, I'm going to send you the number of samples as an unsigned integer that's 4 bytes. So the first thing it does is reads in 4 bytes, treats it like an integer, and then says, okay, now I'm going to keep on reading in data until I've read this many bytes in. And so it just keeps on reading data and waiting until it's received all of its data, and then it can actually start doing something. Because if instead I said, I'm just going to send the data, he doesn't know when the data stops. He doesn't know when the next command to play a different thing or do something else starts. So you have to be intentional with your communication with the Bluetooth device. Another example is, I can just print out data. I can just keep on printing out, and it'll just keep on reading until it reads a certain value, like 0, or like a new line if I'm sending text, that kind of thing. That's a pretty common way of doing things. HTTP, the protocol that we use to send data back and forth between web servers, was made a really long time ago, which means that it was short and sweet. The way that it tells you that a message is done is it just sends 2 new lines. And so whatever packets that it's sending back and forth, when I ask for a web page, when I ask for data from a web page, it will send me data, and when it's done, it sends me 2 new lines. And that's how I know that the file is done. Any questions about this kind of stuff? All right. So I talked a little bit about Peer Finder before. Let's go through it in detail. I will say something like Peer Finder dot alternate identities Bluetooth paired equals this. That is a really weird line. That means, hey, I want to find all paired Bluetooth devices. This alternate identities thing is because the way Peer Finder works is that I tell Peer Finder, this is my application's identity, so match me with anything that matches this identity. So I enter the empty string in order to say, I'll match anybody, and I enter this string to say, on the medium of paired Bluetooth devices. Next, we get a list of all the peers that satisfy those criteria. So notice here I'm using await so that I, even though this is an asynchronous call, I'm not going to do anything further in this function until I've actually gotten a result from all those peers. And that can take multiple seconds. And then we find the first peer that we want. So in this case, I'm saying in this collection of peers, called peers, I want the first element such that its display name contains phone Astra. That is some fancy code syntax that we're not even going to talk about, how it's matching the display name.contains thing. Needless to say, it's using lambdas. That's what that little thing here means. And it's basically passing in a function that gets evaluated on every element of the peers collection and only returns the one for which it's true. It's kind of a weird, funky way of thinking, but it's pretty useful. And so we'll just use this line. And so once we get this peer info, we have its host name, which is its like location on this medium. So if we were talking over TCP/IP, this would be its IP address. Since we're talking over Bluetooth, I believe it's Bluetooth MAC address. And then we say we're connecting on port 1. And port 1 is the magic port that means serial over Bluetooth. And once we do that, we have a serial over Bluetooth connected socket that is that will allow us to read and write data to the phone Astra. We can read and write data with these things called data writer and data reader. So this data writer and data reader thing are objects that we construct on our input and output streams that allow us to do things like read so many bytes and write this line and things like that. There's a sample Bluetooth code that's not yet uploaded, but will be uploaded later tonight, that will do things like it will connect to the phone Astra and it will just read in whatever it sends out. And there's a sample phone Astra C file that we'll use that will allow us to like write out a line of code every second or something like that. And so burning the code onto the phone Astra and running the Bluetooth app on the phone and then pairing them and connecting them will allow us to have data being generated on the phone, or on the phone Astra, and displayed on the phone. It should be noted that there's a lot of async stuff going on with Bluetooth communication here. So this input.loadAsync, that is a function that will wait for 4 bytes to be available to read in. So if the phone Astra has only sent 3 bytes, we're just going to sit there until it's got four, until it's sent another byte. Same thing with write bytes. I can tell it to start writing bytes out, but I won't actually know that it's been sent until I call storeAsync. That makes sure that the bytes have been communicated to the Arduino and that everything's hunky-dory. Any questions about this C-sharp side? If not, let's talk about the Arduino. So the Arduino, we're not going to be programming through Visual Studio. We're going to be programming through the Arduino IDE. And those of you who are like, oh crap, not another toolkit, be happy because the Arduino IDE looks like this. We've got code here, we've got output here, we've got a compile button, and we've got an upload button. And that's pretty much it. It's pretty simple. To program an Arduino, you need 2 functions at minimum. You need a setup function and a loop function. The setup function gets called once at the very beginning of your program, and the loop function gets called as fast as possible, like it's in a while true loop. So in the setup, we could do something like in the loop, we could do things like we'd say serial.print hello. And what that will do is it will take the hello string and transmit it over the Bluetooth network. We can also say, like, if serial.available is greater than 0, so that's checking to see if there are bytes, there are more than 0 bytes available to read in. We can read in, like, a single byte with serial.read. Or if we pass in a number to serial.read, we can read in multiple bytes. We can also do things like output beeps asynchronously with tone. So we can do things like, say, tone at 1,000 hertz for 100 milliseconds. And then we can force ourselves to wait for 100 milliseconds so that we're not trying to do something else during that time. Because, again, you may have felt the wind shifting, we are going to be outputting beeps with our phone Astra. So the setup is pretty simple. You tell the serial to start communicating at a certain baud rate, because we're starting to get into really embedded programming here where we have to configure like the communication rates and stuff so that all our hardware talks to each other at the right rates. We tell the Bluetooth module that we want it to be on, and we turn on a red light. And that's my setup function. That's it. I was going to have a live demo for this where I have this sample code here. I don't know if I can make this guy bigger, unfortunately. Well, I guess I can do that. I have a couple includes up here at the top, which you'll pretty much always include in your phone Astra projects. I have this software serial thing that allows me to do serial input and output. I do my setup just like I had up there. although I appear to have two serial objects. I'm sure I'll figure out why in a second. Sorry? Oh, all right. Then in my loop, I wait 1 second, and then I call print battery. And inside print battery, I do a little bit of stuff that I haven't talked about, where I read in the battery power level. And then after a while, after doing this math, I just print out the raw battery level and the voltage. And that's it. So this is just a sample application to get you on your feet with programming the Arduino. Unfortunately, when I try and upload it, it's not uploading to my Arduino, so I'll have to figure out why that is in a minute. But we can go ahead and take a look at the code for the Bluetooth side of things so that we can get an idea of what it looks like to do communication on the C# side. So I create a stream socket, and then in my constructor I say set up Bluetooth link and start reading data. Set up Bluetooth link is going to return, it's an asynchronous method that returns a task of type bool. And so it does this peer finder alternate identities thing. It's going to go ahead and find all peers that are paired with it. And if there are no peers, it's going to do this message box show thing that says no Bluetooth devices are paired. Please pair. This says NXT car. It should say phone Astra. You can tell I ripped this from an example somewhere. If we do have more than one or more than zero devices, then we look for any that match phone Astra. And if we don't, it says no prepared phone Astra was found, blah, 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 blah. Then finally, if we do have one, then it assigns S to a new stream socket. And if you remember, S is this guy right up here. And it tells the stream socket to connect asynchronously to the host name. If setup Bluetooth link succeeds, then we call read data. Read data will await setup OK. So this is a little tricky to think about, but the setup Bluetooth link returns a task, right? And as soon as we hit an await, it's going to return from this function. And so it's going to return a task, and it'll pass it into read data. And so the first thing read data does is await that task so that we can make sure that everything went OK. Who's confused by this? You guys are awesome. All right. Yeah, if I ask who's not confused by this, will you all raise your hands? No. No, you won't. All right. We then do the same thing that we talked about in this lecture slides, creating these data readers, data writers. I don't expect you guys to accept all this just purely on faith. I expect you guys to go through this code sample that will be posted and ask me a whole bunch of questions on the discussion board, because none of it's commented, apparently. So I will comment it before I upload it. What this application will do is it will allow us to send a little bit of, it'll have a text box, so we can look at the XAML. I can't run it and show you because I'm not uploading to my Arduino properly. There's probably some driver that I need to install, which will definitely be in the homework information for you guys work on your own computers. Could be.
That shouldn't affect the upload though.
It could also be that I've checked the wrong board here. I thought it was the Arduino Mini with 18 mega whatever. But
it looked like you had two serial ports.
You guys are good. Let's see if it compiles and runs. So when you click upload, it will try and compile and then it'll try and upload it. And if it doesn't work, it'll print an anger message down at the bottom, which you guys have probably all figured out by now. It should compile a lot faster on your guys' computers. It's compiling really slowly because I'm running it inside of a virtual machine. But It's still uploading. Nope, didn't work. All right, I'll figure out what's going on wrong later. But essentially, you'll have a text box that you can type into, you have a send button, and then you have a text block that will show you the output of the Arduino, whatever it sends back. And that's what this SAM project called Bluetooth Test will show you. So after I comment it and add it to the materials, it'll be ready for you guys. And you guys can pick it to pieces.
I'm saying that we send something out, and then your Arduino will send something, can send something back.
The Arduino example code that I have right now completely ignores all your input and just spits out the battery level once a second. But if you want to know how to send stuff to the Arduino, this is how. Would you prefer that my application did something else? I can take out the bits that show you how to send stuff to it if you want. All right, let's talk about debugging Bluetooth a little bit. So we have two debugging tools. The first is USB serial output on the Arduino, where you can open up a serial terminal in the Arduino IDE, and you can print out data from the Arduino. Unfortunately, you have to use that software serial thing that I was showing in the Arduino example, this thing. So we have two serial guys. We have software serial, and we have the normal serial. The reason we have that is so that one of them prints out to the Bluetooth and that main thing, and the other one prints out to the PC. So that's the reason we have two of them. So
if you do enable a serial terminal so that you can print to your PC,
I think so.
No, you've got to go into.
Yes, that's what it is. You go to tools and there's serial monitor.
Oh, okay.
And it'll show up right here. Actually, and make sure that you set it to the same baud rate here as on the other one. I wonder if. You think the Arduino IDE has what? Yeah, I will try that later, but I have to install Java in order to make it work, so. Yeah, well, I'll figure it out eventually. It shouldn't take me too long. All right, so for homework 5, I already talked about the image processing part. For the second part, it's going to be a remote Morse code transmitter. So you will enter in a message in text on the phone, which gets, you will enter in Morse code on the phone just to begin with. So you enter like period, period, minus, minus, period, period, minus, minus. And it will just do dot, dot, dash, dash, you know, go da, da, da on the Arduino using the buzzer. If you want, you can have it translate from text to Morse code. So you can type in, you know, hello, and it'll turn the H into whatever, turn the E into the, and it'll turn the O into da da da, right? So that would be really cool, but I'm not going to require you guys to do that because learning Morse code isn't really the point of this class. But I will be very happy if you do it. So this homework is intended to give you an idea of how this kind of communication with the Bluetooth with the Bluetooth device and such actually works. And this part of the homework shouldn't take you very long. So if you get stuck on the image processing part, you can take a break and do this stuff instead. Because you have 2 weeks to do it, which I know means you guys are actually going to all start asking questions like the Saturday before it's due. But hopefully if it's broken down into small enough chunks, you might get some of those chunks done before the time crunch really comes in. And so, this really just brings us to the end of all of the set-in-stone course material. Because once you guys have finished this homework, you will have nothing left to occupy your time, except, your jobs, and also the final project. So we do still have quite a few lectures left. We're only halfway through the quarter. So the way that I have set up this class is that we go on to what I call the bonus lectures. These are where you guys will vote on a list of possible lecture topics, and I'll prepare a lecture and, you know, give it with all the live demonstrations and source code and stuff that you guys could ever want on whatever topics you guys want. So we're talking about things like, we can talk about machine learning, so doing things like SVMs or like linear machine learning and such on the phone. So you can do things like on the phone live, really, really crappy speech recognition, or
we
slightly...
Do we have homeworks on that things?
Sorry?
Do we have homeworks on that bonus lectures?
No.
They're
you guys just get the homework solution after the lecture, basically.
Okay.
So I've done most of these things that I have listed on the bonus topics last year. So we did like advanced signal processing to do things like face detection or like linear predictive coding, like the theory behind it, what it means, how to implement it, and et cetera. We can talk more about the Arduino, how to do things like file I/O on the Arduino, et cetera. We can talk about network communication. So that was actually a pretty popular topic last year, where we did things like we did bare TCP/IP communication with a computer. So I, for instance, had like a MATLAB instance running on the computer, and I was able to communicate with it on the phone. So I could have the phone record something, send it over to MATLAB. MATLAB could do its number crunching thing and then send it back, for those of you guys that love MATLAB. We can do it with any other. I think I did one with Python as well. I did an example where we did like cloud-based speech recognition, where on Microsoft's phone, we bundled up the audio and sent it off to Google's cloud, because Google will do speech recognition for us for free. We can also talk about kind of more advanced networking patterns, where we do things like have multiple devices all talking to each other efficiently, using technologies like 0MQ, which stands for the null message queue. There's really a lot that we can talk about. So what I will do is I'll choose like three of these that I want to talk about, and then I will give you guys a choice to vote, say like, you know, 2 weeks in advance or something. And then that will hopefully give me enough time to prepare everything properly and change all the EE596s to EE590s. And then we rinse and repeat. The big reason why you guys should pay attention to this stuff is, well, I mean, obviously you guys are paying for it, but also because you can subtly influence the lectures in a way such that you get something that helps you with your final projects. Which kind of brings us to the topic of final projects. So I mentioned it briefly last week, but I'm going to really hammer it into your skulls this week that you guys should start working on this pretty soon, and you should send me a written proposal. I say next Monday here, but I realize that you guys will probably want to have a chance to talk to me in person, so I'll probably change that to next Tuesday. That you guys should send me a written proposal by next Tuesday with you and your chosen teammates' names, and a brief description of what you want to do, how long you think it's going to take, and preferably why you think it's awesome. So these projects should be something along the lines of sensing and control, live computation on the device. All these things that we've been doing in the homeworks have been trying to give you the skills necessary to really tackle these projects. And I don't really want to list off like all the kinds of projects that we had last year, because I like new ideas and I like you guys coming up with wacky, insane stuff. There were a couple projects last year that I was like, I'm not sure if that's even going to work, but the students managed to get something that, you know, if it didn't work, at least it was pretty close to working. So I like ingenuity and using the hardware for things that it wasn't originally designed for. That being said, I'd also want it to be possible because it would be really great if it worked at the end. So, I want you guys to take, you know, the next week to really think about it, talk amongst yourselves, and come up with ideas that are feasible to do in, let's see, how many weeks do we have? 5 weeks? 6 weeks? Something like that? And so that you won't, you know, spend the last week as a broken husk of a student trying to get the stupid code to work. So that you actually have something that's, you know, feasible. Any questions about the final project stuff?
Are we doing the live presentation demo stuff
down here? Probably. So last year we did it in one that was a little bit bigger than this. But the only downside to that is that, you know, you don't get GPS signals and stuff like that down here. But it will likely end up being in a classroom. If not this one, then a different one.
So then for deliverables, then you want to report on what we've done? Or is it just the code?
Yeah, so what? So deliverables will include a report and the code and a individual. So the report and the code are group. But there will be an individual component where you talk about your contributions to the project and your experience working with your teammates. So that if you're, you know, if your teammate goes off to Barbados for a month, you have a way to tell me that. The problem with apps that require, like, so for instance, some people did like a exercise app where like they had it would make a breadcrumb on a map as they jogged around and, you know, kept track of where they were and stuff. They could do things like they could demo how it would count jumping jacks, how it would count steps, that kind of thing. But they couldn't demo the GPS tracking feature. So what they did was they made a little video of them doing it and then presented that in class as well. That's totally fun. Stuff that can be presented live, of course, I love live presentations and such. We had a couple presentations last year that basically brought the house down. It was great, but if it can't be done, then a video is a good substitute. Sorry? They had a robot that danced to music, and so they dressed up in like suits and came and brought their robot. Explained why what they originally had planned didn't work at all and why they had decided to do this instead. And they blared Britney Spears and had the robot dancing around in the middle of the room. It was pretty fantastic. That's why I teach this class, really. I want to see that kind of stuff. Well, it was. Oh, I see it says homework 6 here. It should say homework 5. So that's it. Any last questions? We went pretty late today, so if you guys just want to go home now, I wouldn't blame you. But I will be upstairs to pass out these guys and to answer questions and such. If that's it, then I'll see you guys upstairs. You know what? Yeah, why don't you go ahead and just grab it here? So, I don't have a sign out sheet for them right now. I guess, yeah. You guys can go ahead and just grab them here.
I don't have a sign out sheet.
One each?
There should be enough for one each.
Oh, awesome. Really want two.
I'm a little slow tonight.
That's all right.